Today on The Hookup, we're going to talk about why your Wi-Fi sucks and what you can do to fix it. I'm going to explain the most common issues with Wi-Fi networks, and I'm going to show you how to increase your Wi-Fi performance in 5 quick, easy, and free steps. In some regards, Wi-Fi is extremely complicated, but the most common problems are caused by 2 things that are relatively simple to understand, called attenuation and interference. Wi-Fi consists of different frequencies of radio waves, and although radio waves are different than sound waves, a simple analogy can be made between the two to teach you why your Wi-Fi sucks. Imagine you're in a large ballroom, and you want to talk to a person all the way on the other side of the room. If the room is empty, the only limitations will be the volume of your voices and the sensitivity of your ears. Let's say that one person can't talk very loud and they also have really bad hearing. If the other person has great hearing and a loud voice, the conversation can still happen. But if not, there's going to be a lot of, "What did you say?" and "Can you repeat that?" going on, which will decrease the rate of your overall conversation. Wi-Fi devices have the same 2 important characteristics. They have transmit power, or how loud they can talk, and they have antenna gain, or how well they can listen. In most cases, the majority of the data is going to flow from the access point to the device, so that's what we're going to look at first. This video is sponsored by GoSun, manufacturers of quality smart home basics like Wi-Fi plug sockets, light bulbs, and LED strips. Because these GoSun products are Wi-Fi based, you don't need any special hub or receiver to operate them, just your normal 2.4 GHz Wi-Fi network. GoSun products use the extremely popular Tuya platform, meaning setting them up is quick and easy, and the Tuya app can be used with hundreds of products from other companies that are also based on Tuya. If a GoSun product is your first smart home device, you can set up scheduling and operate it remotely via the Tuya app, or easily add them to Amazon Echo or Google Home devices. If you're a seasoned automator, you'll be happy to know that GoSun products integrate easily with Home Assistant and Samsung SmartThings. Check out GoSun's full smart home lineup using the links down in the description. All right, the measurement for how well a Wi-Fi device can hear its access point is called the Received Signal Strength Indicator, or RSSI. RSSI basically measures the difference in the strength of the signal that was sent out by the access point and the signal that was received by the Wi-Fi device. A measurement of 0 dB means that 100% of the transmit power made it to the client, which is basically impossible, and negative 100 dB means that none of the signal made it to the client. In general, you should place your access points so that any device that needs to talk to them has a negative 70 dB or better RSSI. And if it's a high bandwidth device, like a phone, tablet, or streaming device, you should shoot for negative 60 dB or better. So the first step to determining why your Wi-Fi sucks is to figure out the RSSI at each important location throughout your house. To do this for free, you can use a cell phone or a tablet with a Wi-Fi analyzer app. There are tons of good options if you use Android, but if you have an iPhone, there's only one option, since Apple doesn't give app developers access to the tools required to make a proper Wi-Fi analyzer app. So, if you have an iPhone, jump to the App Store and pick up an app called Airport Ultility that's made by Apple. This app is meant to be used with Apple's Wi-Fi solution, but if you download it and then go into settings, you can enable the Wi-Fi scanner within the app. Once Wi-Fi scanner is enabled, you can walk around to different areas of your house and see what kind of signal you're getting from your access points. I recommend checking out important areas like the couch, the patio, and definitely the bathroom. You'll see some channel numbers in between 1 and 11. Those are your 2.4 GHz channels, and the rest should be for 5 GHz. You should pay close attention to the RSSI values listed next to your specific network name. As you move around your house, you're probably going to find some strange pockets of low signal. So let's talk about why those might exist and what you can do to fix them. In our ballroom example, these pockets would be caused by putting up walls or curtains in between our 2 people. Those walls absorb the sound waves and they make it more difficult for one person to hear the other. And some materials are going to absorb more sound than others. This concept of absorbing the wave is called attenuation, which actually describes the reduction of the amplitude of a wave. As a wave passes through an object, it's going to transfer some of its energy into that object based on the physical characteristics of the material and the frequency of the wave. Dense materials generally cause more attenuation, but some materials are also specifically designed to not let electromagnetic radiation through. For instance, I have a Wi-Fi microcontroller outside that controls my pool. Inside, about 15 feet away, is a Unify UAP6 light, which should have more than enough transmit power to reach this device and plenty of antenna gain to hear the response. But my connection consistently sucks. Clearly, putting a microcontroller inside of a weatherproof box isn't great for signal, but even with an external antenna, I have RSSI measurements over negative 70 dB from just 15 feet away. The first problem is concrete, which is what the first floor of my house is made of. Neither Wi-Fi band does a great job penetrating concrete, especially thick concrete block covered in stucco. But what about the window? Most of the time, windows do a great job of letting Wi-Fi signals pass through. Except in Florida, where we try to block as much of the sun's energy as we can to lower our cooling bills. So most windows have a special coating called low E, which specifically reflects electromagnetic radiation, including Wi-Fi signals. You can see that just opening the window improves my RSSI to a nearly perfect negative 40 dB. So step two is to change the placement of your devices as much as possible to increase their chances of getting a good signal. In your house, the Wi-Fi signal can be easily disrupted by things like mechanical closets, metal furniture, or extra thick walls, especially in older houses where the walls are made from metal lath covered in plaster. I know it seems like a great idea to put your router and access point under your desk and out of the way, but you're instantly lowering the signal strength of every device in your house by doing so. Moral of the story, device placement is extremely important. If you have a device that you want to have an extremely fast and stable connection, try to put it in direct line of sight of the Wi-Fi access point. And that leads me to step three, which is choosing the right Wi-Fi frequency for your device. 2.4 GHz is the more common frequency that all Wi-Fi devices can utilize, but 5 GHz will give you higher speeds and in general should have less congestion and interference. Because of this, the general rule that your internet provider tells you is that any compatible devices should go onto the 5 GHz network. However, this isn't always the best advice. The two different Wi-Fi bands are affected differently by different building materials. In general, 2.4 GHz Wi-Fi will attenuate less and therefore have a greater range than 5 GHz Wi-Fi. The reason for this is pretty simple. The shorter 5 GHz wave travels a longer distance inside of every material than the longer 2.4 GHz wave. The more distance it travels, the more opportunity it has to transfer its energy from the wave to the attenuating material, and therefore the signal strength will decrease more with each object that it needs to pass through. If you're experiencing poor Wi-Fi signal to a specific device and your Wi-Fi access point supports splitting the 2.4 GHz and 5 GHz bands into two different network names, try connecting the device you're having trouble with to the 2.4 GHz instead of the 5 GHz network. This will lower the maximum possible speed, but a full signal strength 2.4 GHz connection will be significantly faster than a weak 5 GHz signal. Remember, you can always use that Wi-Fi analyzer to look at the difference in the RSSI values between your 2.4 GHz and 5 GHz networks. Sometimes though, your placement is fine and your signal strength is fine, but your Wi-Fi still sucks. In this case, the culprit is more than likely interference. Moving back to the ballroom, now imagine that there's a bunch of other people in the room having their own separate conversations. Your ears are going to pick up all that extra noise, and it's going to become more and more difficult to differentiate the voice that you want to hear from all the other voices in the room. Luckily, unlike human ears, Wi-Fi has the ability to tune to a very specific frequency range and only transmit and listen on that one small frequency band. So, step four is to change the channel of your Wi-Fi network to avoid interference from neighboring networks. 2.4 GHz is the name that we give to the 802.11n Wi-Fi standard, but it actually has 11 channels that range from 2.41 GHz to 2.47 GHz. The problem is that those 11 channels overlap each other, so there's still a lot of interference between channels 1 and 2, 2 and 3, and so on. The 2.4 GHz band actually only has three non-overlapping channels, which are 1, 6, and 11. When you're using your Wi-Fi analyzer, you should check to make sure there aren't any other Wi-Fi networks with strong signals on the same channel as you. Also, if you see that your neighbor's Wi-Fi is using a channel like 3 or 9, it might be worth respectfully mentioning to them that they are ruining two non-overlapping channels with their Wi-Fi channel selection. They likely have no idea that they're doing that. For 5 GHz Wi-Fi, there are 24 non-overlapping channels, so it should theoretically be easier to find a channel without interference. But a majority of those channels have restrictions for when and where they can be used, and a large chunk of them are known as DFS channels, meaning you can't manually select those channels because they could interfere with other services on that frequency, like military radar. Still, because the 5 GHz band has a higher rate of attenuation and therefore a lower range, Wi-Fi network congestion and interference is usually less of a problem on the 5 GHz band. And you probably won't need to worry about scanning and manually selecting a channel for your 5 GHz unless you live in a very densely populated area like an apartment complex. If you do, then these are the non-overlapping channels that you should be looking for. Last, your neighbors might not be the problem. Step 5 is to make sure that there aren't any devices in your house broadcasting their own SSIDs. It's common for smart home devices to broadcast their own access points for setup, and streaming devices like the Roku have a Wi-Fi network for direct connection mode. If you aren't using these features, it's best to disable them to prevent any unnecessary interference and Wi-Fi congestion. Worse yet, if you've installed new Wi-Fi in your house other than the one provided by your cable company, make sure you disable the Wi-Fi on your cable modem and router. And that leads me to my last point. If you've gone through these 5 steps and your Wi-Fi is still bad, it might be time for some new equipment. The Wi-Fi from your internet service provider is not designed to cover an entire 2,000 square foot home, no matter what they tell you. So upgrading it is almost certainly going to increase your Wi-Fi performance. There are 2 schools of thought when upgrading your Wi-Fi. You can either get a single unit with a massive array of antennas, which I wouldn't recommend, or you could get a mesh system. Mesh systems work by having one main unit that connects to your cable modem and then satellite units that you plug in throughout your house. These systems typically work by communicating with each other on a separate frequency called the backhaul, and then they each broadcast their own wireless networks with the same SSID. You'll be able to seamlessly roam between the different networks, and because the satellite units are located throughout your house, you're more likely to have a direct line of sight to one of them at any given time, meaning your wireless signal is going to be stronger. Another less talked about benefit of these mesh systems is that because the maximum distance from one of the satellite units to a Wi-Fi client will be less than just having a single access point, the transmit power of the networks can be significantly lower, leading to less interference with your neighbor's Wi-Fi and less congestion in general. It's fun to be able to connect to your Wi-Fi network from a block away, but it definitely is not best practice for security or even performance. As for equipment recommendations, I used the Google Wi-Fi 3 pack for my 2,200 square foot house for years before switching to a Ubiquiti Unify system. Aside from the lack of advanced options and firewall rules, the Google Wi-Fi system worked great for me. And I've also heard good things about the Linksys Velop system from a friend who does residential installs, but I don't have any first-hand experience with it. If you're feeling especially tech savvy and your pockets are deep, you might decide to go all in on a Ubiquiti Unify prosumer setup. If so, check out my recent 3-part series about Ubiquiti Unify using the Dream Machine Pro and the Unify UAP 6 Lite access points. Thank you so much to my awesome patrons over at Patreon for your continued support of my channel. And if you're interested in supporting my channel, please check out the links down in the description. If you enjoyed this video, please hit that thumbs up button and consider subscribing. And as always, thanks for watching The Hookup.